Fantastic. Yeah, I know Valentine's Day is what, Friday, the 14th? Maybe we'll get a pre-start on it. I think that's a good idea. It's always nicer to do Valentine's Day before the fact rather than after the fact. And the reason is that what we do is when we give out love, we receive love back in return. And we've got to get ourselves prepped for that loving that's coming up, right? Don't you agree? Don't you remember being a kid in school? Am I the only one who was a kid in school and handed out all those little cards that you had? I was at my grandchildren's yesterday, and they were prepping and making the cards. They do them online now. He was doing Minecraft cards for all the kids in his class, and the little one, I think, was doing Disneyland cards that his mother would print off of online. But we used to go and buy those big boxes and try to figure it out. Right? Do you remember that? Remember getting all those cards and then you'd sit down? And if your mother was like my mother, and not all mothers were like my mother, but you had to have a list of every child in the school that was there or in your class, because it wasn't okay to give out a card to everybody but one or two people. That wasn't allowed to happen. You had to be open and sharing about how you did it. And the reason was because if you didn't give somebody a card, it didn't matter whether or not it was an oversight. What happened was that person would feel badly that they didn't get one. And I know every Valentine's Day for years, I didn't care for it. And the reason I didn't care for it was because I was always frightened that I'd go to class and somebody wouldn't give me a card, one person. And I remember times when it didn't happen. It didn't matter that I had 25 beautiful cards in front of me from people who said, "Will you be my Valentine?" and "I love you," and all those sweet things that were said. What really irked me were the two or three that didn't give me a card, even though it might be an oversight, or even though they might not have had cards, or even though they might not have had a mother who told them to give one to everybody. It's amazing how you can feel the absence of it rather than feel the gift of it when it comes in. Have you noticed that about love? Anybody here ever felt like they were cut out? That they were perhaps not counted? That they weren't accepted? Oh gosh, I'm the only one. Oh, Irene Kowalczyk. Thank God I'm not alone. It really hurts my neuroses when I find out I'm the only one, again, who didn't get a card. Yeah. Love is an interesting thing, because what love is it is an action, it's a verb. We're accustomed to using it. One of the biggest problems we have with the English language is that we use love to define so many things in our lives. Yeah, you know, I love my wife. I love my grandchildren. I love you. I love apple pie. I love Pete Seeger. I love the music of Pete Seeger. I love logos. I love the sun in the morning and the stars at night. And all of it is an activity. It's an action. And when we apply that in that means and in that way, what occurs for us is that we awaken something within each other in the way that we do that. Our appreciation for it is demonstrated in an energy that comes back that's invisible, that we can't see, that we can't feel. You know, I remember years ago being told that the opposite of love is not hate. The opposite of love is indifference. And the reason why the opposite of love is indifference as opposed to hate is because even hate is a dysfunctional form of love. Any time that you apply some energy to another human being or to another area or to another thing, what you're doing is you're showering it with some kind of energy that goes with it. So what hate really is hate is dysfunctional love. That's how it works. And so I can only imagine what would happen if we really had an understanding of what the love we're talking about means. How it means that we have a concern and a caring for what we're doing and how we're doing it. How we look upon something and we do it from that place within our heart which is complete, which isn't hateful or isn't absent or isn't indifferent, that we actually care. The other thing that I grew up with was a father and a mother who would say things to me like, I'm only doing this because I love you. This is going to hurt me more than it hurts you. Once again, am I the only one who heard those lines? I'm old enough to know Pete Seeger. I might be old enough to be the only one. You know, that sentiment and that idea that went behind it, that I'm being guided and directed by a loving concern and a loving care. I remember my daughter once coming to Deborah and I and telling us that she knew that we were loved because we cared enough to take care of her and discipline her and show her in the right direction. She was such a suckle. It worked so well for her. But really, that's what it is that we do things like that in a loving manner, in a loving way. And if you look at your own life and you look at the situation that you have, what kind of energy do you have when you stretch out to rearrange someone? When you decide that what you're going to do is change a circumstance or a situation in another person's life, do you do it from the sentiment that this is going to be a healthy thing for them? Is this a loving thing that you're doing? Is it functionally loving for how you're doing it? Or is it in reality a reaction to something within your own being and within your own self? When we look at conflict in the world that's around us, and we can look at that from the larger picture, and we can imagine it being brought into the smaller picture of our individual life, but when we look at it, do we react to other countries that are doing things that we don't agree with? Do we react from an attitude or from a feeling that what happens is that we need to redirect it for the good of all, or do we do it out of vengeance? Do we do it out of anger? Do we do it out of hatred? Because when we do, what happens is that we end up doing that in a very dysfunctional manner, and it is another taint to what we call love. Like I say, love has so many meanings. It has so many different ways that we can look at it. And if we don't learn to look at it as a verb, if we don't learn to look at it as an activity or an action that we do with the world, then the end result is we have a way of being able to bring it and make it into that smaller point where we allow all of our negative emotions to pour from us to fill that particular area. I'm sure, and I'm only guessing, but I'm sure that most people in this room have someone or something that they don't think that they love, that they don't care for, that they would like to change. It might be a politician, it might be an associate, it might be just an attitude, it might be a political stance, it might be any number of things, it might be the cold weather. But when we look upon it from that energy of trying to discharge and make something different, what we're really doing is we're feeding that out into the world, which is bound to come back to us again. Because one of the things that we know with an absolute certainty is that the attitude of the energy that we put out into the world comes back to us. It shows up in our life and shows up in our circumstance in a way that brings and attracts to our being and to our experience that which looks just like it. So we find ourselves in situations a lot of times where what we want to do is we want to change things because we're not in support of the behavior behind that. And when we pour out that bile that goes with it, when we pour out that energy of less than that naturally follows from that, what happens is we get to attract it back into our life. So, you know, very early in my experience and in my life, I learned that love has got to be clean. So what I began to do is I began to look at the things in my life, and if I really cared for them, and if I really desired them, and if I really wanted them to be in my life, I learned that I had to be clean and I had to be clear in how I treated it. You know, even when we have conflict in our lives with someone that we love, such as if Deborah and I have conflict, which has happened a couple of times in the last 40 years, just a couple. But what has happened is, how do you react to that? And you know, my initial response to a lot of the cases when I was younger was that if something occurred where it really irked me what she was doing, what would happen is I would respond to it with an energy which was not loving. I would respond to it with a rage or with an anger, and I would begin to flash that out into her circumstance or her life. And it's not just her that I would do that with. I would do it with my mother and father. I would do it with my sisters. I would do it with my brother. I would do it with you. What it was an immature means of me being able to reach out and demonstrate what I thought about you or her or them in a way that didn't reflect back what the truth of my actual energy was. Because there was something that stood between me and it in that verb situation. There was some activity that stood there that would not allow me to break through to the other side. And it was only when it became clear in my mind that my intention preceded my emotion that I began to get the idea that I could transform the world and change things. And here's what I found. I found that when I began to act upon my love rather than beginning to act upon my indifference or my own stuff, that the end result would be is that I would have a receptive pattern to fall into. Do you know what I'm talking about? Have you ever found yourself railing on something and then wondering why that something continues to grow and expand in your life and in your situation? That is a misuse of the law. It is a misuse of your activity. It is a misuse of your emotions. And so many times in the midst of it, what happened for me was it had nothing to do with what I was dealing with in the first place. It had to do with my own fears. And I could take it right back and respond it to the, or to place it on the fact that, you know, it's even the feeling that I would have when I would go as a little child to Valentine's Day at school and the fear that maybe perhaps I wouldn't receive something. Not that any other day it really mattered to me whether or not I did, but that recognition and that knowledge and that knowing. And my behavior from that point forward really was one of being able to reach out for love on a regular basis. And if it wasn't given back again, if it was indifferent, if it was withheld, then the end result is that I would become upset, but I wouldn't become upset with what I was looking at. I would become upset with my own feelings and my own thoughts and my own being. We live in a world that is rife with this, that doesn't have that clarity and appreciation and understanding of what's going on. And we know this stuff. We already, everyone does, but we know we can resonate with it. And what happens to us in our world and what happens to us in our lives is oftentimes when we come into a conflict with another human being or with a group of human beings, what we immediately do is we begin to withhold and become indifferent to them. We begin to demonstrate it by not showing up, by not being present in what's happening. And that grows and that builds in that person, and then it reflects back and builds in the other, and it becomes a mirror of war within a mirror. You know, the secret to holding love and maintaining love, not just on Valentine's Day, but on any day, is to know that you must do this from a verb point of view. That love isn't something that we receive, love is something that we give. And when we give it, what happens is everything smooths out, because what we do is we reassure and create a calmness that fits over everything else. So, you know, the circumstance and the gift of it is to realize that we can transform our experience by transforming the way we look at the outpicturing of it. By realizing that what we can do is we can change the circumstance in our lives to one that is loving by being loving with it. And sometimes it's a real challenge. Sometimes it's a challenge to be loving with something that you actually feel isn't working right or isn't working correctly. To use a term that I learned a long time ago not to use, to feel that it's to love something that you think you hate. I remember speaking to a friend of mine once and saying that I hated something. I don't know whether it was hating the cold weather or whether it was hating broccoli, but whatever it was, I can remember saying and using that word, and this was a very influential minister in my life, and I remember him turning to me and saying, "We don't hate anything." And the reason he said that was because that hatred is an energy that we put out there of a really dysfunctional form of dealing with something. We're not indifferent to it, and we don't hate it. What we do is we clean our consciousness so that what we can do is embrace it and bring it into our life. And we're more, we prioritize more the behavior that we have as opposed to the behavior that we receive. Have you ever, how many of you are on Facebook? Yeah, six of you. You're my friend. Facebook is this social media tool which allows you to communicate with a lot of people at any given time, which I don't need to fill in. I'm sure you all know what it is. But down in the corner of it, it's got a thing called like. It doesn't have a thing called hate. It's called a thing called like. And when you like that, when you press that little button, what happens is everything that person does for a while shows up on your screen. Have you noticed that? At least that's the way my understanding of it is. And the incredible thing is that our lives are very, very similar to it. Except that we have that third button. We have that button that says dislike. And when we press that dislike, everything shows up. So that in our life, what occurs to us is we have those options or those opportunities. And a lot of times what happens is when we love something or like something, we press it, and we're glad to have that come in, that information to come in. But when we press that one that says dislike, that one comes in too to us. It shows up in our life. What I guess I'm trying to say here and what I'm trying to put across is that Valentine's Day is an opportunity for us to know within ourselves that there's something for us to do. It's like every other holiday or every other day. It represents not something for us to get, but for something for us to do, to be able to provide. So I will tell you something, is that that problem relationship that you have in your life, or that relationship that works, or that relationship that you haven't spent any time on, or that relationship that you're trying to avoid, demands that you show some love to it, that you give some love to it. So what I'm going to do this year is I'm going to look back on those things that I'm frightened of, that I don't really want to go near, and what I'm going to do is send a personal note to it. I'm going to send a personal note to someone who I haven't talked to for a long time. I'm going to demonstrate my love, and I'm going to take and be proactive about it, and I'm going to put it out there into the world. So we have about 5 days until Valentine's Day right now, six days until Valentine's Day. And what I would have you do, if you choose, is I would have you make a list of the people in your life that you would like to love. The people in your life that maybe perhaps you haven't noticed for a while. The people in your life who perhaps you've noticed in a negative fashion. And what I would have you do is I would have you create a way to respond to it, which is loving. It might simply be a note that says, I want to let you know how much I appreciate you. It might be a Valentine's Day card that says, I love you. It might just be, I know you're out there, and I've been looking for you. But there is an activity and an action that's available for you to be able to transform your life. I don't think in this world that there's anything as important as that activity of love. I happen to believe, as Emerson said, that God and love are synonyms. And that when we apply that care, that conscious awareness to the world around us, what we will do is transform it. We can transform it in our individual life by recognizing the people in our lives that perhaps we've forgotten or put aside. We can create and manifest something in our lives on the bigger picture by appreciating and understanding something that is happening and knowing that our reaction to it can come from a sacred heart and a clean place. That we can come from a point of view of saying, I love you, but I don't love the behavior. I don't love the activity. I look at the world around us and I realize how vindictive and vengeful we can be. How we can respond with a punishment idea. And I will tell you something, as Holmes said, is the world's learned enough through suffering and punishment. We don't need to do that anymore. What we can begin to do is to be clear and clean in how we react to other people. All of the great sages have said the same thing, which is that love is the power that can overcome everything else. Now, we can utilize that in our lives, or we can continue to carry on with our own little fears and our own little thoughts that we're not enough, or that the world isn't enough, or that someone else or something else isn't enough. But I'll tell you, when we begin to respond from that place of our heart, where we realize the clarity and the truth behind it, and we realize that showing it difference will apply to it a way that it can come back and show us the same, that's the key to success, and that's the key to a world that works for everyone. I trust that you all have someone, something very, very large or very, very small to be able to embrace and hold as your Valentine this year. I trust that you have that feeling and that sense within yourself of that compassion and that caring and that love that is the truth that really can and will free the whole world. And I trust that you put it into activity and action and quit waiting for it to happen for you and instead begin to use it for others. And that's my message today. Thank you, and know that you're loved. I love you.